Avengers were formed to make the world a safer place. I feel we've done that.
The world owes the Avengers an unpayable debt. You have fought for us, protected us, risked your lives. But while a great many people see you as heroes, there are some who would prefer the word vigilantes.
When we were sitting down and beginning to think of the third Captain America film, we realized that Winter Soldier and the fact that audiences had embraced that film all around the world gave us the leeway to do things that were tonally somewhat different than we'd done in our films in the past, but also do things that have incredible repercussions for the films to come. There's one storyline from the comics that is the epitome of bringing the Marvel characters to a turning point, and it's Civil War.
Iron Man and Cap have such a good juxtaposition. They come from such opposite worlds in their beliefs and their personality, and it just builds this really wonderful friction.
The concept of Civil War is very important to us. We felt like we needed to go in a radical direction if we were going to do another Captain America film.
When you flip through the issues of Civil War, you'll have, in any given panel, a dozen characters fighting a dozen characters. And there are hundreds of characters over the course of that seven-issue book.
It was always led by character, and then spectacle would follow.
Marvel and Kevin, particularly, don't mind the big swings. So the thing that maybe some people might step away from and say, oh, it's too early for this, yeah, or we don't have enough characters or whatever, that we couldn't possibly do that, they go, let's try it. And in trying it and in developing it, we all, oh, this won't be exactly like the comic, but boy, this will be pretty cool.
By this point, people know Steve Rogers very, very well. People know Tony Stark very, very well. We know how they work together, and we know that they have some issues with each other. They're very, very different people.
You know, you may not be a threat, but you better stop pretending to be a hero.
A hero? Like you? You're a laboratory experiment, Rogers.
The book, Civil War, is so grounded in this idea of Captain America leading one side versus Iron Man leading the other side that we just felt that if we were going to try it in the MCU, it was critical that we had those two components.
Civil War became the overriding principle. It was like, we do realize we need Robert.
Wow, it's so weird how you run into people at the airport. Don't you think that's weird?
Definitely weird.
To me, what's super exciting is like Cap needs to grow and change and have darker, more complex challenges. And I think for Tony, it's like, you know, what are the real world challenges and ramifications of dealing with superheroes on planet Earth?
There's no decision-making process involved for me here. We need to be put in check.
Watching the two of them together and seeing them, you know, being in the moment and listening to each other was absolutely so much fun to watch.
Everybody is always looking for ways to surprise themselves and surprise audiences about where we can go. And we had a very clear idea about how we wanted to do it, that with this movie. And I think once Robert got into that, he became very, very excited about it. And he's been an amazing collaborator on this film.
It's no secret, I love Chris Evans. I deeply respect the guy, and I learned from working with him. And he's also really reverential to me, which goes a long way.
Downey might be my favorite actor. And it's just, it's such a, the, you know.
I'm glad we spoke before this little sit down.
The fact that now Iron Man and almost every Avenger is in Captain America Civil War showcases just how far we've come in the development of the cinematic universe. That we can now, with these beloved actors, these beloved, globally recognized, iconic characters, bring to life some spectacular storylines from the comics is a dream come true.
The movie is consciously an effort to bring some of the tone and style of Winter Soldier and merge it with a new style that we're going to use for Infinity War, which is a grander scale look and less handheld. So the styles are merged, and as the movie progresses, it shifts from one tone and style to another. And that was very important to us.
Yeah, this is going to be a great shot.
Directing is storytelling. And when you hear them engaging you in the story and coming up with ideas and seeing the glint in their eye, the excitement about doing something like this, you know you have something special.
Love the Russos. Love me some Russos.
We just have a pretty good line of communication open between us.
There's nothing I don't like about them as directors. There's just kind of a simpatico with the way that I like to influence things and then step back and really follow their lead. It's just this kind of dance, this creative dance you want to have.
They know these comic books and these scripts inside and out. I think it wasn't a fluke what they did on Cap 2. You know, and now coming into this, you see it. You see the footage. They just have an eye and a gift for telling these stories.
Yeah, the wings pop out, he does that.
as you come down. We're here on day one on set, and what we're working on right now is the first fight between Captain America and his rival. You gotta get out there. Oh, shit! And then he got.
We want these fights to be big character moments. We don't want there to be fighting just for the hell of fighting. There's a lot of story coming into these fights. And Sebastian in the last one did a bit of fighting, quite a bit, but not as much as he did on this one. Seb put in so much work in pre-prep to train these fights. With Chris the same. Chris will pick up fights so quickly where if it's hand-to-hand combat, they're so good you can use them. And that is a better way to shoot fights because you see more of the actor, you can shoot wider, you don't have to hide anything when it's your real actors doing this combat. The Bucky apartment sequence, that was insane because that is like a Kickstarter for action in this movie because it starts with the apartment, goes to the stairwell, goes outside the apartment, and then into the second unit where they did that epic car chase.
3, 2, 1, action!
Next to him, he just slips his arm in right before he jacks out the door.
We follow the continuing story of the Winter Soldier, who Captain America cares very much about and who believes he can get his best friend back.
Bucky was the guy who's always been there, he's always had his back, and Steve's a loyal guy. I'm sure there's a certain sense of guilt based on what happened to Bucky.
Which Bucky am I talking to?
Your mom's name is Sarah. You used to wear a newspaper in your shoes.
As much as Civil War is the trappings of the film, it's really about Steve making a decision for the first time that's personal over sort of a global version of doing the right thing.
I was really excited when I read the script. I didn't really know where they were gonna take it because the playing field was so open they could have done anything with the character. What was fun about the script was that when you were reading him, you never knew where he was gonna swing, which side of the fence. He might become the Winter Soldier, he might be Bucky Barnes. So there was a lot of playing room there, and that was fun.
More kills than anyone in Hydra history, and that was before the serum.
You know, my main goal over the past 3 movies has been to find Bucky. So now that I've found him, is just trying to nurture a relationship between the metal arm guy.
You were that in it.
I was in it.
You were in it.
I was going from the beginning of the movie.
Falcon, who is Cap's new brother in arms, is his best friend in the modern world.
Full on Avenger. Hey, you're looking at an Avenger guy. Remember that. This guy, yeah, thank you.
Marvel has made a concerted effort to help Sam Wilson evolve into an Avenger. It's great. I love my new suit. I got my little splash of red. I got Tony Starkerized. Yeah, he high-teched up my suit, and I got Red Wing.
Thanks, Sam.
Don't thank me.
I'm not thinking that thing.
What I'm holding is the scale model of Red Wing. A lot of the flying around we'll be doing with CG, but when we go out on set, we like to have lighting reference. So we'll shoot a shot with CG Red Wing. You won't see any Red Wing flying around, but afterwards we'll walk in and then pretend like we're flying Red Wing with the model on the stick. And then when it appears in the theater, it'll look real.
I got my new jetpack. There's nothing, you know, natural about flying for a human.
Man, it's so annoying that you guys won't let me fly.
But, you know, I could be doing worse. I could be a superhero that runs and I'd just be running around all day.
I'm so tired. How many takes of this are we doing?
Action, action!
There's a giant set piece that opens the film in Lagos, Nigeria, which is a lot of fun. Our amazing locations team found this back lot, essentially, where we built Lagos, Nigeria, which wasn't an easy feat. When you're able to film in places that are a 360-degree real environment, it allows the cameramen a lot more freedom as to how they frame shots. It allows the stunt guys to really build things in an environment that's real, that gives them scale, so that when you see the film, it's really gonna feel as if you've gone to Africa.
Yeah. Where we at? We're back in Lagos. We got Crossbones doing his thing today. Frank Grillo in the house.
I thought this would be a great opportunity to have
just an unapologetic, murderous, venomous villain who could kind of stand his ground with these superheroes.
Sorry, I don't work like that anymore.
Get me another superhero, I'll bang him up too. When I saw the costume, I was excited. The look of it was kind of post-apocalyptic. It suits the character. Like when I get in the suit, I feel mean, I feel angry.
You know, Rumlow has a history with Cap. And when they get to the point where they are about to apprehend him.
You know, I know you. Your pal, your buddy, your Bucky.
Rumlow blows up a bomb, trying to blow himself and Cap up. Luckily, Scarlet Witch is close enough where she can contain the bomb with her powers and get it away from them, but it ends up killing a few bystanders.
I remember reading it and being really excited by my character's just arc in general. I like the idea of her being terrified of her own abilities. The Russos wanted to really keep Wanda's movement to be Wanda's movement, because that's what makes her unique. So what the new elements that we are adding is flying, floating, those kinds of things. It's not just shooting energy towards robots. There's some things that aren't just about like being harmful. It's about moving things. It's about helping Cap take a jump. Like, how do I get energy to launch him?
We try to ground it in this sort of telekinesis, applied telekinesis. Mm. It seems like she's getting better at it all the time.
Yeah.
And we'd love to draw on that for Infinity War TBD.
Yeah.
If you were to ask us who we think the most powerful in the universe is at the moment, just based on what we've seen on screen, it's the Scarlet Witch. That makes her a very interesting character because she's also the youngest.
Her abilities are just probably the most formidable. I think we need each other in a lot of ways. You know, I need her abilities for a lot of things, and then she needs me to kind of keep her head straight. She's kind of a loose cannon, insecure and powerful and just all terrifying in itself. The Russo brothers was my first time working with them. They're very passionate about this universe, but they're also just cinephiles in general. And they refer to a lot of different things. You know, they refer to, like, you know, Hawkeye's like, maybe I think like Han Solo. I'm like, well, I'm glad you think that way, because that's kind of what I was kind of hoping for, very irreverent and kind of same sort of skill set, essentially.
Don't you think Laura would be disappointed?
Me or you?
What you're seeing here is the third version, the Hawkeye bow. Made a few changes, lightweight, easy to handle. We took back and went to the Avengers 1 quiver with a few modifications. It's slick, it's thinner, it's lighter, easy to work with. The bow, we need to make the draw pretty easy for certain scenes. And the way to do it is we take the bow, we pull it back, we make a mold in this position and remake the entire bow so that when he grabs it, he needs to pull fast, not too much stress. We have a 12-hour day, he's got to pull it in excess of 100 times a day. Got to help him out.
Buckled in?
Yeah. No, I'm good. I'm good, Arrow guy. Let's go, let's go!
One of my most favorite things in this universe is when the characters use each other's assets or their abilities to even be better. And I kind of do it with Ant-Man.
Coffee in him, but he's all right. Right?
When I showed up here for the first time and was doing a scene with Captain America and Falcon and all of them, it's like, whoa, I turned into a bit of a 10-year-old. It was pretty strange and really cool. And kind of the first time I thought, man, I really am part of it.
This is awesome. It's Captain America. You. It's right on.
I think on the face of it, if you think of Ant-Man, you think, man, he's gonna be overmatched when he faces the other Avengers. But the truth is, the power to shrink is something that shouldn't be overlooked.
I'm the boss, I'm the boss, I'm the boss.
I'm the boss!
The new suit is really streamlined and looks a little more high-tech. Now it looks like it's been tricked out and kind of fits in with modern times a little bit more. And it was exciting. You know, I had that same feeling as when I tried it on the very first time in Ant-Man, which is just, I'm looking in the mirror like, this looks awesome.
Oh, what the hell was that?
The helmet is different. You know, they're no longer the cables that snap back into the back of the helmet.
Antennas go up from the bottom now.
The regulator is different. There's no dial on it.
I think that Hank and Scott have been hard at work really getting this thing fine-tuned.
Ant-Man has the history of the anti-Stark sentiment as expressed by Hank Pym in Ant-Man.
Guess Hank was right. You never can trust a Stark.
He lines up pretty cleanly on Cap's side. You want to surprise the audience, and you want to make some choices that are interesting, because if everyone can predict who's going to be on whose side going into the movie, we didn't do our job right. So there are some, you know, surprising choices made in the film.
But also, I would say what was really determinative, too, was it was really important to us that every single character had a personal, emotional reason for making the choice that they made. That was trackable in their arc from the beginning to the end of the movie. And sort of that, I think, was the most fun part of deciding who sided where, was figuring out what on the deepest level could move these characters to go one way or the other.
Well, it's not villain versus hero. It's friends. It's family. This is sometimes the most dramatic conflict, when it's people that actually have a history and care about each other. I obviously start out with Falcon, Mackie. You know, he's been Cap's right-hand man for a while now.
Falcon, he slows everybody down. You know, he's like the character, like the bigger guy in the Goonies. That's how I look at him.
And we've since, you know, we found Bucky first, we broke him free, so we in turn have the Winter Soldier on our squad as well. We also have the Scarlet Witch.
I was just kind of looking around like, we've got a really good team, you guys. And it felt that way. And we had like all the jokey people on our team.
What are you guys doing?
What's up, dude? Don't worry about it. It's just a...
run through the fire or something?
We recruit Paul Rudd. We recruit Ant-Man. Mackie does, because Mackie has a little history with him.
I thought I didn't have any abilities. What's Ant-Man going to do?
Can't forget Renner. We get Hawkeye. That's a huge get.
We're facing off what I think is a pretty good team on the other side, too, if I think about it.
Tony's side is a little more complex.
The surprise members of that team is Black Widow.
You partially agree with me.
I would like to take that.
This is unprecedented. I'm thrilled.
She makes an ideological choice rather than an emotional choice. The emotional choice, obviously, would be the side with Cap.
It's painful, I think, that she's, I don't want to say turned her back to Steve, but she's definitely, you know, she's gone a different direction.
What are you doing here?
I didn't want you to be alone.
They do care about each other. They are, in some ways, a brother and sister, but it doesn't mean they agree about everything all the time. And that's what makes Civil War so compelling, is the people that you would naturally think would flock together are split apart by something that's very real.
In the absence of Fury, she's thinking like a Nick Fury in this movie.
More guns, which means more headaches for somebody, probably us. What makes this character really heroic is that she's kind of dug her heels in and said, look, you know, I could kind of go down this road, which would be the more desirable road personally, but she chooses this kind of greater calling. And in this film, we really see her move closer to a kind of leadership position.
You'll have to understand if we seem a little blindsided.
We knew someone was going to have to think one way and then see the consequences of their actions and turn. We chose Natasha as the one who could have a conscience ultimately and say, oh, this is too far.
She's a bit torn in her relationship with Tony. I think she really sees Tony very clearly, sees his weaknesses as being a danger for the team.
You don't get it, Stark. It's not yours to handle. It's clear you can't be objective. I'm putting special ops on this.
What happens when the shooting starts? What, do you kill Steve Rogers?
Well, it's great always to bring back a character into the universe who has a point of view, and then apply that point of view or alter it slightly, give them a new presentation.
What if I told you we were putting a team together? Who's we?
We thought it'd be interesting to take General Ross, who was this hard ass, give him a heart attack, mellow him out a little bit, but give him that same agenda of control.
Everyone was on board, which made it great. There was a lot of excitement and enthusiasm. I mean, he's a phenomenal actor.
Found something. 40 years in the Army never taught me perspective.
If you get William hurt, you gotta use him.
You seriously think I'm gonna listen to you after that fiasco in Leipzig? You're lucky you're not in one of these cells.
It's funny, because I have a bit of a trippy kind of, you know, arc with him, but I adore the guy.
How'd they look?
Thrilled, Tony. They look thrilled.
I was absolutely riveted by the comics and found them to be so imaginative and so morally authentic. They asked real questions. One thing that I've always wondered about in all my readings of all of these superhero comic books, what about the collateral damage? Suddenly I've got lines about it, and I've been waiting for that all my life.
For the past 4 years, you've operated with unlimited power and no supervision.
They want us to sign the Sokovia Accords, which will allow the UN to tell us when and where to go. Steve feels this is the wrong move, Tony feels it's the right move. And that kind of begins the conflict.
You need an actor of his magnitude and his presence to be able to stand in front of that group of actors, hold the room, and make the audience fear for the future of the Avengers.
And if we come to a decision you don't like?
Then you retire.
Rhodey, the War Machine, here's a guy who's only really ever served in the military. So the idea of oversight to him is nothing new.
Right, 117 countries want to ratify this. You're just like, nah, we got it.
Look, how long are you going to play both sides?
There's only one side, Sam.
It's usually Rhodey who's trying to pull Tony back. And now Tony is saying, no, I'm kind of on this side, and we need to do it this way. It's nice to have still yet another progression to their relationship.
We need to be put in check. Whatever form that needs to take, I don't care. I'm game.
I don't want to be in a universe where Rhodey and Stark aren't still brothers. And they've been through so much that it would be like, that to me is almost would be like, that's too many fractures.
War Machine has a whole new look. He's a lot bulkier than he was in the previous movies. It feels like he's back to like being a full-size, almost wearable tank in a lot of ways.
Sorry, Cap, this won't kill you, but it ain't gonna tickle either.
Every time I'm in the suit, there's improvements. It gets lighter and lighter. So this suit is probably the lightest and most, you know, malleable it's been yet. I could actually touch my nose with my arms this time. So I was very happy with the suit.
Stand down now.